Yeah, I wanted to finish what was last time, and also to some people told me that this, to see if this thing is settled, because it's unclear if it is settled. So it's about the fact that short modes lead to long, might lead to zeta being time dependent. Let me summarize, what was discussed last time. A study about a blue mode and the effect of long mode and of short modes on it. And last time we saw that there was projection effects on this mode, longer wavelength modes, which means longer than the modes are longer than the current horizon, have absolutely no projection effect. Shorter than the current horizon, the projection dynamical effect that starts at horizon re-entry. That is, just to be clear, this is a vanishing correlation before horizon crossing. There's not even need to compute it. That is, this means that I can do the, if for example, I can do the calculation in a frame where the static correlation function between long mode, between a certain mode and modes longer than the mode I'm interested in, are zero, and I get the same effect, because the effect computed in moving coordinates air heating cancels out. So all these modes have no effect on the heating surface or up to horizon re-entry. So there is no worry from the CETA, we can use astrophysics course. So this argument that I presented last time doesn't mean that the calculations in moving coordinates are wrong. It actually means that they're right. That is, this shows that you can do the calculation in the moving coordinates, and when you compute something observable, this IR dependence at one point in the theta between k and any k much longer than the k of interest, even inside the horizon now, will cancel. And the new, there are new effects that comes just from horizon crossing, re-entry, from horizon re-entry now. Instead, shorter wavelength modes do something, do a true projection effect, because they enhance the scale over which a certain k-mode is projected to long distances. This is a physical effect, because it changes the relation between scale and the amplitude of the power spectrum. And as we mentioned, it was the short version of slow light and inflation, which I think this resummation, I think it's understood, this resummation. I'm not claiming that eternal inflation is understood, but this part of eternal inflation, I think, is understood. So the other thing that was missing the other day was that there are dynamical, potential dynamical effects from short modes on long mode that are, last time I just said that they are zero, but it's not trivial. And I think I want to show the result. But last time, it's 2 years of the work of research, he told me, why you said it's a tragedy? So let me just remind you why it's a tragedy if zeta becomes time dependent. Of course, we're all interested in the zeta space, blah, blah, so I'll just give you some addenda to your or motivation. I mean, here in the quantum gravity group, it's okay. But let me just give you some addenda you might not know. So, as we said the other day, the eternal inflation is an interesting phenomenon where the reheating surface, as you make the potential of the inflaton flatter and flatter, at some point, this reheating surface becomes more and more curved, and its volume can become infinite. That is, there's a probability of obtaining infinite volume which is different from zero. This, I think, it's interesting for the community because, first of all, it's a nice geometry, but also because, as I mentioned, there is this bound. That is, the probability to obtain any volume which is finite but bigger than e to the s d theta over 2 is zero, is non-perturbed in quantum gravity, which tells you that there is a bound of how much finite volume one can obtain, which is not infinite. And I'm not going to explain these plots, but you can see that this, first of all, this bound is super universal. Anything that we found to compute respect this bound. And I think it's a consistent check of the holographic interpretation of the zeta space.
Well, let me see if I understand that. When you say SDS, is that the Euclidean action evaluated?
No, sorry, this is the zeta entropy at the end of inflation. Oh, would be the zeta space with the Hubble equal the Hubble at the end of inflation.
Could you write it to me what it is, what SDS is? I'm not familiar with that notation.
S entropy of the zeta ds equal m plus square over h square.
Negative words. So yeah. 1 over g h squared, right? Is that correct?
Yeah. I mean, yes. In the units, you prefer. Yeah. And for pi equal 1.
So another reason I think we care about this is because it's an example where we basically can't compute the wave function of the universe, and it's not because we don't understand the ultraviolet. We don't know what to do, basically, with the wave function and the observables. And it's an extreme IR problem.
Yeah, I agree with that. This is just the beginning. I think this is the first time some description of the geometry of raw inflation was given in a reliable way. It doesn't solve these problems at all. It just maybe offers a way to begin to address them with formulas.
Well, some quantitative description of at least some aspects of it. So that's great. But I think it touches on some of our profound.
I think this is the first.
Really grappling with.
Yeah, I think this is the first hit to a wall. I mean. Yeah.
Okay, so I have some questions about even what it means. So what does V mean?
Okay, so this was just motivation. But this, if you take a certain box and fill it with the inflaton up to the top, all on top of the potential, and you study, inflation will go in each point on the box, so the box expands, and it will have a certain volume at the end. This volume is well defined. It's the volume of the heating surface.
Is it the volume of the classical geometry on the three surface that is homogeneous and isotropic? Is that a definition of it?
The definition of the heating surface is defined as when phi, whatever phi is equal to phi heating. And since the time derivative of phi is time-like, you can check that it's always time-like, even in the inflation.
Is phi reheating a constant?
Yeah, it's a value 10 GeV. Yeah.
So it's just a number, and so that's saying that phi is
homogeneous.
Is spatially homogeneous.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, and V is the classical three volume of the thing on that surface, is that correct? Is that what I mean by that statement?
Yeah, I'm not sure why you say classical, but
I don't know. I'm just trying to say. One of the things I try and do sometimes is talk about observables.
Yeah, so I think it's the quantum.
I could define a quantum three volume, but whenever I do that, then the usual suspects will say, no, you could do it different ways, blah, 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 blah.
Apart from modes shorter than a half ball, which are a bit of an if, if you could just cut off with modes, just consider all contribution from modes bigger than a half ball, this volume is a quantum mechanical quantity, so it fluctuates and follows a probability distribution that you can compute. However, it's very, very semi-classical, the story, because in inflation, as you know, maybe modes become quickly semi-classical. So, but it is stochastic. It has a probability. It has a vector probability distribution with an average volume and a width. This is the probability to obtain a certain value of the volume of this surface. And it fluctuates. So what we can write, we'll write the probability distribution.
So
it's not a wave function.
What does that statement mean, and what happens when
this wave function is cut off.
So the wave function doesn't even exist for fluctuations that get bigger than a certain amount.
Exactly. It's very small. This tail is incredibly small. And so there's a kind of...
How did the wave function ever stop? Or how could quantum mechanics not ever apply?
I'm very happy if you want to think about that. It's a mystery. It's a mystery why it stops at SDS over 2. So if it doesn't stop at SDS over 2, it's infinite.
How could it stop at anything? I'm sorry, I don't understand.
Well, by stop, you just mean it's very exponentially suppressed.
Yeah, so all the realization of the universe, other create a volume which is finite, that is end, the end inflation everywhere, globally. We were producing an overall volume which is less than SDS over 2, or by the time they produce SDS over 2 volume, they are so big that they can never end. And so the volume that they produce is infinite. So there is this divide between, infinite spaces.
I see, this is a conditional probability. This is that there is no evolution that will end up in our kind of a universe if the wave function ever has support.
These are the distribution for the V. When the V is a finite number, well, it's finite, it's not infinite. I can extend it to infinity, that is, you have to prove a point here, and there's a small delta function at V equal infinity here, so that the integral of this distribution over all V, including infinity, is 1, but if you remove the point at infinity, it's less than 1. This is, I think, the most accurate definition we have so far of slow roll return inflation, and it's a very mysterious fact why there is this bound. In fact, people like the IQ might find some region or entropy, I don't know. Yeah, it holds many dimensions. This relationship is incredibly universal, but both as the sitter. For example, you horse by the higher order correction to gravity. So this is the world entropy, which you remember is very complicated, but the volume is correctly in exactly the same way, so that it is SDS over 2. And you might remember that in the black hole, the page time is S black hole over 2. So I don't, yeah, it's very, very suggestive, though nobody has a good interpretation of this, a sharp interpretation of this true fact, as far as I know.
Is it important that I understand this? Because I don't understand those two statements.
No, I don't think it's so important that I understand it.
Okay, maybe.
In the sense that this is just motivational, but I'm happy to explain more later. So all these results on the Italian inflation go to vanish if this superfacial zeta, delta phi, receive these corrections. Because in this case, a coincidence, they will go like, the superfacial will go like t squared, and this would change radically this picture, these results. Because all it would mean that all inflation solutions are either always, no matter how you start, either eternal or never eternal. So eternal inflation could be completely non-existent, and so it has potential consequences from the landscape and entropic solution, the cosmological constant. So these results of eternal inflation rely on zeta being constant.
Even if inflation is going to end classically in less time than it would take for the quantum, for a big quantum fluctuation to put it over that bound, why is it a problem?
Because I think this bound is interesting. Okay. I mean, you might not find it interesting. It's okay.
Would you like to be recorded for this?
Well, okay. I don't mind, but it's okay. Sorry, I forgot. I don't know. I don't like to be recorded because then I have to be very polite.
It's completely up to you.
But it's okay. I think
maybe you can ask for editing out a few.
Last time I was very Anglo-Saxon. And I repented. So another reason why maybe you care, this is the predictivity of inflation. This is why we said that it's a tragedy. So if zeta were to be time dependent, then in inflation we get this correction, the one loop plus this correction times 10 times log a of t. This number is 10 to minus 10. So in inflation, this is a very, very small effect. But it's still it would be like the bird in the sorry. It would reveal a deep problem.
But do you really think that the loop corrections go like that? They go like that. That's gh squared over epsilon.
You want to put an epsilon on top?
Yeah.
Fine. Put an epsilon. Put as many epsilon you want. The problem is that what we do when we study inflation is that there is a zeta epoch and moons cross the horizon, cross the Hubble horizon. The horizon is much bigger than the Hubble. And then there is a long time where we don't know what the physics of the universe is, baryogenesis, leptogenesis, all this stuff, and then more enter inside the horizon. It's crucial for the predictivity of inflation that we don't need to know what happens there to observe things in the sky. That's why we can say, M squared phi squared is constrained by not seeing B moves, because we don't need to know, because everything is conserved when it's super Hubble. If this will become Hubble, if it will become time dependent, things will not be conserved on super Hubble. There's a short modes. Short-distance physics affected long-distance physics. And while this number is very small, there are other times in the universe, like phase transition, for example, reheating, where the corresponding number, with as many epsilon as you want, is 1. So, during inflation is a weakly coupled set to study the effect of short modes on long mode. This effect in inflation is very small. But in reheating, there are black hole, fluctuations are very large. During phase transition and baryogenesis, there is electroweak phase transition, there are bubbles colliding. These fluctuations are very large. This means that the coupling cost of the loops, which is a gravitational coupling constant, is 1.
I see. So I think I finally understand your worry about that. You're assuming that that coupling constant there, or the loop counting parameter, is the local GH squared, the thing that changes with time, right? That's your assumption.
Yeah. This is the worry, yeah. This is what would happen.
Then doesn't that get smaller with time, rather than get a lot smaller with time, rather than bigger?
The perturbations are over the 1, actually, at the horizon.
I would have said gh squared is already 10 to the minus 11.
No, sorry. I don't think it's gh squared. I think it's delta rho over rho. It's delta rho over rho. That's the real coupling constant.
Well, that right there is gh squared
that's
over
also delta, that's also delta rho over rho. I think the expansion parameter, as you know, the expansion parameter is zetas, which is delta over rho.
Really, I know that. That's gh squared over epsilon, because see, epsilon is a minus h dot over h squared. So take one of the h squareds, put it over the h dot. You've got a 1 over epsilon, 1 over minus epsilon. Implying, what
yes,
implying
but, is g. Yeah, but this is zeta. Yeah, I agree with you. G, because in inflation, zeta is g squared over epsilon. But the induced zeta from short modes, eta reheating is over the 1.
But if it's that coupling that's
yeah,
working.
I'm not, yes, but I'm applying the same result to a different part of the history of the universe, where the coupling costs are different, but the physical principles are the same. There is still 1 degree of freedom. And if there is a back reaction, that time is going to be large.
But I think anybody who ever did that calculation and got such effects, they only considered that calculation to be valid during inflation. They would
yeah.
not have trusted
yes,
that.
But the problem is the principle. Well, I'm interested in a statement of principle. If there is such an effect in inflation, there is going to be such an effect in reheating also.
Why does that follow?
Because it's the same logic, okay? I'm just, because that,
okay,
of
let's,
course...
Okay, let's play the game the other way around. The original tree order result also goes
sorry,
like
I mean,
that.
I don't want to take everybody's time on this point, but I mean, this is the discussion, so I can continue, or if the other wants to see the bottom line, just let me know. I mean, I know with him we can just continue, but...
maybe
just
that's not so important
to,
either.
I mean, I just want to get to the point, to the end.
Okay,
time.
Why don't you get to the point? I probably would be better.
So I think this is a... that's why, in principle, it's important to establish a quantum level that we don't care of what happens at short distances for the predictions of inflation when the modes are super Hubble. And also, in the 50s, people understood clearly, let's understand perturbation theory in inflation because it's the theory of the early universe. It's just important for us to understand it. So let's study this effect of short modes on long mode, okay? Where it is in a mode which is longer than the horizon, can short modes change in commoving coordinate, can it induce a time dependence on this? Now, what does it mean to compute the loop corrections in inflation? It really means to solve perturbative equation of motion. That is, at quantum level, we compute the expectation value on the interactive vacuum of the zeta variable, which in the interaction picture is written like this. This is the interaction picture of evolutor with rotation to pick up the interacting vacuum. And so this is the Frefnir vacuum. Once you begin to expand this term, you find that there are commutators, because there is H is on both sides. You find that the formula can be rearranged in form of commutators. 2 times with the cubic, 1 times with the quartic, and so as many as you want. Each one of these contractions give a diagram. And it's true, as pointed out by Rahmer, that every single diagram gives you, I mean, the last majority of the diagram give you a zeta squared that goes like HT. So exactly the fear, the tragedy I was wondering, okay? It gives, every single diagram gives this contribution. The question is, does all the diagram cancel and give zero contribution?
But so it's... just for clarity, so are you going to compute that zeta?
Yeah.
What I meant is, okay, in your talk, you introduced another quantity.
No, I think this is I think this is just a red herring. That is, my talk introduced this quantity,
well,
zeta,
up,
zeta of e to the minus zeta big round,
right.
Something like that. This is just to give you a quick argument, a very simple argument that IR divergences from modes longer than k, instead in this talk and concentrated here, okay, but to show that this mode cancel.
Right.
Once you know the cancel, you can stick to the old zeta, okay? And just do the calculation of the old
okay,
zeta.
Okay, so your stance is basically, your attitude is basically, so let's compute zeta, that gives that quantity.
Yeah, that's giving me this quantity. I will get the IR divergences. I just cut it off because I know that if I compute something in my eyes, they will cancel
yes,
by this argument. So this argument is just a proof that you can do the calculation in commoving coordinates, okay?
So you're saying that there are such secular effects in the naive zeta zeta correlator, is that correct?
No, he's talking about the IR, the other effects, not the time.
Yeah. Thank you, Guilherme. Yeah.
Okay.
This effect, I'm talking about the K log, much less than K, that she asked.
Yes.
This effect, if you compute intermediate parts of the calculation in commoving coordinates, you will get them. But if you compute the 2-point function of the temperature as a function of the angle in your eyes, they will cancel. So there is no worry of computing in zeta, zeta correlation function in commoving coordinates, because this I know that these terms are going to cancel at the end. and approved it by this argument.
Is this not in the naive zeta zeta correlator, in some other.
But you don't see, nobody sees the zeta zeta correlator. I see temperature at one angle,
Now you're just saying why it's good to use the other correlator, and I'm not disagreeing, I just want to.
No, I don't think it's useful to use the other correlator. I say that the other correlator.
But could we just be clear?
Yes.
Does the naive zeta zeta correlator have those effects or not?
The zeta zeta correlator has those effects, but the zeta zeta correlator is not something that is observable.
Oh, okay, fine.
And since I proved that on something observable, the effect cancel, then there is no worry from keeping the log L effects in the statistical correlator as intermediate steps. Sorry, what were you asking?
This result of Weinberg that you're quoting, is that an exact de Sitter background?
No, even in fact, the proof I show is all the it's also in Israel.
But I mean, would it hold in de Sitter, exact de Sitter, according
now,
to Weinberg?
Now, the zeta variable is a bit sick in the zeta space. The zeta variable is sick in the space because we're really talking about the scalar degree of freedom that drives inflation.
Right.
Which is written in this unitary gauge, which is zeta. Now, if for standards around inflation, the de Sitter limit is not well defined.
No, I see.
Because it becomes, a slower time inflation, for example. You can calculate a tensor power spectrum. But anyway, it's important that the Sitter ends, otherwise we don't really know.
And it would show such things, the naive one.
I suppose that also for gammas, every single diagram will let this. Mm-hmm. We're trying to prove it at some point.
Yeah.
I think that the same argument, actually, you'll see that the same argument applies to photons, to gravitons, to show that the contribution of every single diagram gives this term, but then they cancel.
The
in fact, Weinberg, by the way, didn't claim that it's time dependent. It showed that it didn't exclude the possibility that diagrams cancel.
Right, he established a bound, which is a right bound. But what was the statement about photons?
Gravitons.
Right, so you could look at the tensor.
And the argument I show trivially applies also to those.
But so in the case of gravitons, we don't need to have the inflaton, and then we could
exactly.
Do an exact de Sitter. And then
exactly.
Why can't I just invoke de Sitter invariance of the vacuum to rule out?
No, because I think this is because this de Sitter ends, so we're doing the calculation in different coordinates than the static patch.
It's not a standard.
Yeah, you can. Of course, you can try to do what you want. But I think the coordinate this would be if you try to do the Sitter, it would be the Sitter that must end. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense to compute these quantities because these are super Hubble correlator in FRW slicing of the Sitter space, which is not the naive the Sitter. So, for example, the Poincaré patch doesn't cover this slice, right? So. I don't know.
But how would you?
You see what I mean? The concrete patch.
You're assuming that the vacuum is the Sitter invariant.
Doesn't extend it.
How do I know that?
Yeah.
I guess I just believe that there is a definition of a de Sitter invariant vacuum that, well, I guess it's a formal definition, but.
I don't have any reason to think
it doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Why is
it? This is not a subject that I think.
No, the only thing I think is that this is not the quantity we are observing. If you are in the Poincaré patch, you don't see these modes.
So you're claiming that you've got a definition that holds when interactions are present?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just talking about like the path integral, the Euclidean path integral definition, which you then, continue to define a state in Lorentzian signature, and it just evolves, and it's de Sitter invariant by construction.
Right. And the honest statement there is that many people have done that, including myself, for linearized gravitons. Nothing goes wrong. No one, to my knowledge, has done anything. For those who think something will happen in interactions, no one has done that.
Yeah, but
I'm not disputing anything. Mm. I agree.
Even though I think, in general, I think it's interesting to look from the visitor point of view, but I think this calculation is not the one of relevance here because. This de Sitter must end, so you want to compute.
Yeah, and anyway, it would certainly be important if this scalar in the context of inflation was growing. So, I mean,
it's
important to explicitly show that this Weinberg conclusion is not correct or is correct.
No, let me just, since Weinberg is my myth, Weinberg noticed that all diagrams give time dependence, but it didn't exclude the possibility of cancellation on diagrams, so it didn't claim that the final result can.
Yeah, by the way, related to this question, so what do you say about the growth of the graviton variance? At long times.
So I'm not one of the many people that have looked at this in a lot of detail, many of which are here, but my guess is just that they're not looking at, you know, Gaussian variant. It's not a Gaussian variant correlator, so.
Yeah, but in the sitter, this is very tricky, in the sitter. For example, if you take the Poincaré patch, some modes, you can see that some modes of these modes are exiting the Hubble, so they're going away from your description, and while some modes are generated. So the modes that I see in FRW, there's a constant set in the Poincaré patch, because some modes cross the horizon, but some modes are generated, roughly speaking. This is static by definition. And this is not what happens in the FRW slicing. So,
You see what I'm trying to say, that in Poincaré patch, one is static by definition. So
yes.
There's not even a question, as you said. It's just a question of what is the amplitude, but the fact is not independent.
Yeah, but that's not the nature of the argument I was imagining. I'm not using the static patch, using the full global symmetry of De Sitter.
Well, if you look at the full global spacetime, you do have a growing tensor variance. Now, you could attempt to argue that that's just not physical, but it's not clear that's right. And I actually think there are indications that it's wrong, that in fact, the geometry is becoming, in some sense, strongly fluctuating at large scales. That you have, you think of an orange or something that's expanding, and it's becoming lumpy on larger and larger scales as it expands.
Are you talking about the time, a secular effect, or just the IR?
I think there's a projection effect.
Or just an effect.
The question is whether there are different variant observables that describe them or not. Okay. If so, if there are Gaussian variant observables that describe them, they're a feature of the state, period. They may not be something you could see by if you're a local observer in the state, but there's still a feature of the wave function of the universe that's Gaussian variant. And we've made some attempt to quantify these.
So actually, we addressed about the graviton correlators in up to nonlinears. Then it's not directly about that computation, but we address the loop corrections, and we show that is just suppressed at big scales.
Well,
so I think it
maybe for looking at local quantities, but I'm not. Did you look at sort of quantities that characterize
the
global structure of the structure of the geometry at longer scales?
Well, what we did is basically the giving the computing the past the vertex interactions, and then giving the order of the computing the time dependence of that. Then if the
time
mode.
Time dependence of what?
Sorry.
Time dependence of what?
Of the vertex integrals. And then if we choose a Euclidean vacuum, which is basically the bunch depth in the data state, then that effect is just suppressed.
Yes, but there will be still the projection, the same projection effect that makes this region larger. It's going to be there. The same projection effect that makes this is going to also be there.
It's the same as curvature perturbation.
It's the same kind of effect, but I would call this a projection effect. I mean, it's really important if you care about the region.
Well, it's a geometric effect. But gravity is geometric.
So if you're saying that you've studied the vertex
I think it's something that is not locally observable.
Whether we call it geometrical or projection, maybe that's...
I think I gave a definition of projection, which is a great problem, but it's the fact that locally things you don't observe this effect. Locally, there is no...
By projection, you mean you have to look non-locally.
Exactly. Okay. So a local observer... But instead, the effect I'm talking about, which indeed in the former talk was called dynamical, an observer in the city space will realize about that, will notice that. I'm trying to distinguish these two effects.
It's not true. It's just that it's just the way that you formulate it. I get confused every time.
So I think it's the opposite. It removes completely the confusion. Then you can automatically say it the way you prefer. But I think it just
whenever I ask you, I get the impression that we agree. But then I hear you explain it, and then I get confused again. But you
because in the beginning we didn't agree, and maybe later we agree, right? So that is the fact that, there is no there is no physical correlation between modes longer than the mode of interest induced during inflation. But all this correlation is induced at horizontal re-entry. So, I repeat the statement.
That depends on, if you write the local coordinates, what you say is true, right?
This means that it's true. If I can find a coordinate where this is true, I can do the calculation where there is no correlation between long modes and the mode of interest. I start with zero. I find the result. This is the correct result, that's it.
Yeah, but I think that's totally inherent in the way we do the calculation. So I think that I could never have disagreed to that, because what we do is that we do this usual trick of writing the correlator in the coordinates where there's no effect, and then Taylor expanding in those coordinates locally. Right?
Yes, but I wasn't claiming that there is an effect from the number of folded from the beginning of inflation, right? So it's okay.
No, but
there is no effect.
I think what we're saying is that when the modes interest the horizon, right, then when you compare different parts of the sky, there is an effect of the mode.
Yeah, and this mode is only induced by horizon reentry. It has nothing to do with the sitter. I can even not compute what the sitter did, okay?
But that's okay. So
but this was already discussed last time. Today I'm talking about this dynamical effect. So if I'm guaranteed I can get to the end,
I think we are kind of derailing.
So I think it's recorded. You can re-listen to it. It's a firm statement.
Okay, but I was going to ask you a question that would but we can ask afterwards. No problem.
Sounds good. This is recorded. It's pretty been repeated several times. So what I want to give you instead is an intuitive interpretation of these loops. Because these loops are equivalent to solving the equation of motion of the field, where the equation of motion are some, the Lambert operator equals some source at nth order. These loops are equivalent to solving iteratively the equation of motion. The equation of motion iteratively will be that the linear equation of motion is sourced by a nonlinear term evaluated at the lower order solution, and so the nth order solution is some Gris function on the source evaluated with the lower order solution. Notice that this structure is exactly the same, because if I begin to do the commutators explicitly, you find that clearly here the zeta will contain zeta, and you might remember that the Gris function is the commutator of two zetas, so you can really see that this structure is emerging. In fact, Feynman diagrams is nothing but solving perturbatively the equation of motion. It's equivalent. The quantum.
So now we are specifying
taking the expectation
the
value of the solution.
Yes.
Yeah. To the
correct. Thanks. Now, as I said, so this I think should build up you some intuition. It's not something scary, mysterious. It's just solving the equation of motion. Now the difficulty. I think one of the two main difficulties on solving this problem is the fact that we're interested in the coupling between the long mode and short modes. Now, in the zeta gauge, the long mode, the zeta is put in this frame, where delta phi is equal to zero, to fix any diffeomorphism, especially diffeomorphism choosing that. And so we would like to think that zeta, when it's very long, is just irrelevant, it's just degenerate with the rescaling of A. This is a true intuition, this is the basis and why the theory, the zeta is conservative, so that, because it's just a rescaling of the core, of the scale factor, which doesn't play any physical role. But this is not manifest at all in this gauge. The fact that the long mode is a trivial mode is not manifest because if you take the solution to the constant equation for an I, you find that diverges as k log goes to zero. So if naively, the an I term induced by long mode grows at long distances. In fact, if you look at, for example, the tangible terms, you need to use the boundary terms because this actually grows like x, this term in real space. So I think the story simplifies a lot if you find instead a nicer coordinate. Again, we're just interested on the effect of short modes on a certain long mode. So a leading order in the well number of the mode, we can go to local coordinates where in a certain patch of the long mode, we can do a gauge transformation that keeps us in this gauge, where delta phi is absent, so there is no scalar mode. And locally, the metric looks very nice, which is just a time-dependent rescaling, and then a special metric, where the special metric is in anisotropic. Since the mode has some well number, the local metric is anisotropic. There is an overall rescaling called zeta tilde, and then there is also an anisotropic coefficient. This is the metric for if k points in the z direction. And also, there is a relationship between this what is called Laplace function and our zeta tilde, and both zeta tilde and lambda tilde, the overall scaling of the local metric and the anisotropic coefficient are very simple functions of the global variable, which are two properties. So in this way of writing the metric, any dependence on the log mod is manifestly local. There is no 1 over k long appearing in any expression. It just manifests locally. So zeta depends only on zeta, zeta tilde depends on zeta at the same location. And the metric is doesn't depend on 1 over the derivatives of the log mod. So the decoupling of the gradient of the log mod is made manifest.
So this is just a technical point. So are you stick to the one loop or?
But this is all loops.
N also gets a non-local such contribution in higher order, I guess. Perhaps.
Where? Sorry?
At higher orders.
Yes, but in respect to the, you're talking about this,
right?
Yeah, sorry.
What I meant is just the same
thing. In respect to the form of this, you can always do this, this change of coordinate.
Did you make the decoupling manifest, or did you just define a new variable that didn't have any low modes?
That didn't have any what?
Low modes.
No, it has long mode. This is long mode. What do you mean? It is this is a variable which is.
So I got a little bit confused in all the coordinate transformations, but it seemed to me like what you did was to suck the low modes of zeta into your scale factors, sort of. Is that correct or is that not correct?
No. This is a example. This zeta tilde contains also the I and I. This zeta tilde. This relationship. This term comes from the I and I, which can be expressed in this kind of formula. So it's not. So we went to a frame where the k long limit to zero can be taken simply.
Yeah, it's more or less like so the ni on n is given by the Poisson type equation. So because of that, he is giving the kind of the local boundary condition to determine the.
Yeah, I'm just asking in terms of his original zeta variable, what does doing this change mean?
It's a change of variable. You can think of it as a change of variable.
So it's a different variable that's going to
become zeta tilde, which is this function of zeta.
I see. Okay. So would it be a fair statement to say that the original variable zeta is not a constant?
No. And the point would be that if constants of one implies the constants of the other, of course, you can check. Constant in one implies the constant in the other.
How can that be true?
Because it's just a scalar field, right? I mean, is that why?
How can that be true in the M transfer? I'm lost. So if you don't need to do it, then why do it? How does it?
Because this makes the local coupling between long mode and short modes manifest. And it's a change of coordinate. If you put zeta tilde to zero, you can solve and you find that zeta long is dot. If zeta tilde dot is zero, zeta long dot is also zero.
So those H things don't have any time dependency?
No, but you have to take the derivative.
The integral dt of that thing doesn't have any time dependency?
Yeah, but the solution would be zeta dot equals zeta dot. Maybe I should have seen for zeta dot, but you see zeta dot multiplies everything.
It looks for sure like taking the derivative with respect to t of that thing would...
So you remove this again, zeta dot equals zeta tilde dot equals zeta dot plus something proportional to zeta dot. So zeta dot zero is the solution both zeta dot zero. Zeta tilde zero implies zeta dot equals zero. Oh, you can take the time derivative, it will just get the integral. This is a function of t prime. This is all function of t prime.
Right. It looks like those factors of h and everything are.
These are function of t prime, so when you take the derivative with respect to t, you don't hit them.
But now
this part is proportional to zeta dot of t. So
it's suppressed at the big scale.
You get zeta tilde dot of t equal zeta dot of t times something non zero. Something non zero. Okay? Which is 1 plus a third h dot over h, blah blah.
So it's that there's an overall zeta dot.
Yeah.
Kill anything that's multiplied.
Yeah.
If it's zero.
Yeah,
that's right.
This gauge is just, I think geometrically you're just saying you take, you have these surfaces of constant phi.
Yes.
And then you just look at the curves that are orthogonal everywhere to those surfaces.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
find
yeah,
the
yeah.
spatial coordinates to be constant. On
yeah, I just put the ni to zero locally. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, just right. That. I'm just putting ni, the what is called some lapse, the ni.
The shift.
Yeah. The shift to zero. Yeah, just that.
And I guess that's important because The fact that the ship grows. What?
He's saying it's not important.
It's important.
It's technically useful because the scale low going to zero limits becomes easier to treat.
You see, because the labs, the shift, we know that what matters to the shift is the J of the shift, right? But the shift itself looks very bad. But at the end of the day, only the gradients of the shift should matter. But it's not manifest in the calculation until the very end. And now, but since it only matters that, let me make it manifest from the very beginning.
Yeah. Can I ask a question about the spatial coordinates of that? So the integral on the right hand side of that equation, it doesn't depend on x. Does it have any x dependence anymore?
So no, because this is all done. It's done only in the limit of long wavelength of the long mode. So. Maybe it should be x of x tilde.
There's x's on the left-hand side, and there's an x in the first term, though.
It's the same location. It's just a change of coordinate between two scalar fluctuations at the same location. Maybe this is confusing. Sorry, it should have been written as x of x tilde. Sorry, I apologize for the typo, but it's the same location.
Is x tilde
is it because the x is taken to be the origin of the new frame?
Is x tilde time dependent? I think it is, isn't it? Surely it is. It's got a time, it's got an mij of t, right? So when you differentiate with respect to t, you'll take a space derivative of the zeta l, whatever zeta l is.
But I think for zeta, yes, but for zeta dot constant, no, because the two times, I think, are the same.
No. Once you switch coordinates, the partial derivative with respect to t, by definition, holds fixed your spatial coordinates.
Exactly. So I'm not touching t.
I think he's just saying that the transformation to the new coordinates from the old ones will involve t. Once he's made the transformation, now he's just working in the new coordinates.
Yeah, I think, by the way, this construction could...
Spatial.
This construction could have been done also in a global frame. Actually, we just didn't do it because, I think it's nice to use it.
I don't understand that, Ted. If I'm taking on the right-hand side, I'm taking d by dt of that thing, right? Holding x tilde fixed. Is that what I'm doing?
Right, yeah, I think that's right.
And surely that's going to induce Well,
there'll also be x tilde dependence on the right, but that's held fixed, just like on the left.
Okay,
anyway, but gradients of this mode are very small. That is, these gradients are suppressed by k over ah. So, I mean, again, it's all the long. So, those dependents will be down by k over ah. So, they just go away. Gradients of the modes are very good. So, gradients upstairs are very good. The real problem. So, this construction. Okay, you can sit down and work on the mathematical formulas. This paper will be there for a long time. But the problem is that the gradients were downstairs, right? Having gradients upstairs is not a problem at all. They are zero. In fact, I should say that, as maybe will appear later, the time divergences come. The maximum time divergence, as Wander said, is logarithmic, and come from taking just the short modes as constant. I mean, as soon as you hit it with a gradient, there is no issue. Okay. As soon as there are some terms that naively don't have a gradient of the long upstairs, so. There is a logarithmic divergence. As soon as we put a k over a upstairs, it just makes everything immediately manifestly convergent. Probably are the terms that don't have a k long over a there. So these differences are all higher order in k long over a h, which is part of the construction neglected because they are manifestly okay. As one has said, the most divergences are logarithmic.
Maybe none of this technical stuff is important. Why don't we go ahead with the proof? I'm not sure I understand it.
So I think it's pretty obvious. But now, therefore, we solve this equation of motion now in this frame. It's the same equation of motion that's written in a different frame. And since everything was local, the source function of the long mode will depend locally on the on these local modes because on the long modes in the local frame because. This was the metric variable, okay? They were all just manifestly local in the original long mode, and so in this one. And in a very complicated the short modes, because the short modes fluctuate with time, very, very complicated. Also, this source depends on the lower order. it's an iterative solution, so it depends on the lower order long wavelength fluctuations. So you can make a proof by iteration. That is, you can assume that the lower order zeta long is constant and check if the next order is constant as well, and then go by induction. Now, there is a property of this Grease function which is very useful. Now, a leading order in gradients, this Grease function is locally spaced. And so it simply connects points at the same location. Okay? Correction to D are down by K over AH, or if you think it's because they're outside the range.
So that means that previous equation, it wasn't the zero vector, it was X vector, is that right?
X vector, yes. But these are all gradients are kind of negligible here. So this equation you can write it as dt plus 3h plus k square over ah. But this part is irrelevant when the mode is long, very long. Gives a small correction.
Okay, but I'm just trying to follow the steps and I keep getting lost in the steps.
So the Grease function, you should know the Grease function of a mode of a massless field in the Sitter space. When it's super humble, the gradient part is a small correction. So to linear approximation K long over AH, it takes this form. That's why I'm trying to go, because Franco Giddings already left. That's why sometimes I try to go. Because, then we can talk forever, but then. Maybe I should do like the other people. This is a true fact. I will not stop forever on this point. The Grease function of this differential equation is this, and the corrections are small, which means, being this an ordinary differential equation, that's the Grease function, you see that connects point at the same location. Now, the Grease function, you can just find what it is. It is the exponential of minus 3h t minus t prime. This is a leading order Zeroorlin parameter, but you can generalize, but it's the same property. The very important property for the proof of this Grease function is that if you fix t prime at some time, as you make t goes to infinity, the Grease function is zero. This means that if you want a time dependence for zeta dot, you need to a non-zero source here. And to have a non-zero source here at infinite time, you better have s of t prime evaluated at t prime very close to t, about an arbitrary time. Because if t prime is stuck in every time, the effect is zero.
I thought that source term has determinant, which is proportional to typically, I thought this is logarithmic.
Naively. No, the problem is that, this is just a true fact, but so what I'm saying is that the source term, to be important, must be source in late time. Naively, every single diagram has a very dangerous late time contribution.
Right.
Okay, we're not there yet. So this means that there is an important theorem by Maldacena that tells that when you take this guy in late time, the long mode, this is the same, the long mode we're considering is outside the horizon. So the mode is long, and so you could imagine this source contains only long mode, but this is a theorem by Maldacena that tells you that when all modes are outside the horizon, the source term for zeta dot is zero. This is why the constant of zeta at all level was already proven for when all modes are outside the horizon. When all modes are outside the horizon, the interaction term is zero, which means that some of the modes in this source must be short. So this SM must contain a short mode, because otherwise it is. Okay, let me concentrate just on connected correlation function of this S, because if this connected correlation function is zero, then the proof holds.
Could I ask about that proof of Maldacena now? He didn't have all the interaction vertices. How could he have proven that?
If you read carefully the paper, there is a section called constant of zeta at all orders outside the horizon.
Constant
I think I usually remember even the name and the number of the sections.
So
everybody who works in this field knows the paper about the Senna by heart. Do you remember the number? Maybe five. Yeah.
So
the next to last.
Somebody else is claiming to have proved that already.
Yeah, somebody else is called Maldacena, is kind of famous.
What are you doing?
No, but when everything is outside of the horizon.
When everything is outside the horizon. And also we just checked it, it's trivial to see that if all modes are outside the horizon, it comes from the symmetry of zeta, that is, you are not allowed to write any term, a term with no absolute no derivative. You are not allowed to write it. So at least one derivative must be there. If all modes are outside the horizon, then the term is zero. But at loop level, you can have two short modes and a long. Two short modes multiplying giving a long mode. So that's the dangerous term. So the interaction term must have short term entities. Anyway, is it a thing to check? If you take any action so zeta, put the gradient to zero, you get zero.
Yeah, it's kind of just like, so the scaling symmetry is restricting the presence of the mass. So if we neglect all the derivatives, massless field should be just conserved. Just saying, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, the statement, the technical statement is that there are no powers of zeta in the action. No, it has to come with derivatives, so it has to have, you know, zeta dot times zeta to the n, or d zeta squared times zeta to the n.
How does it not have a factor of e to the 3 zeta?
It cancels out.
I'm talking about terms only, so Dirac terms, so every term, okay, sorry, but I mean, this is kind of basic, but you terms must be like this, for example. There cannot be any term like this. A term like this is not there. Terms like this is present.
Yeah.
Okay? Mixed terms. So zeta doesn't have a trivial symmetry. That's why we're having this discussion. Because it couples zeta without derivatives appear in the action. But always at least one term must have a derivative acting on it. Actually, it cannot be even be a time derivative. Because you can eat it by parts. It's really a special of two time derivatives. That's a true fact.
And you know that when you solve the constraints for n and ni, you don't have to pick up such terms?
Yeah, that was the point of Maldus.
It was implemented from the general invariance.
I'm assuming
from the diffeomorphism.
How do I see that from diffeomorphism?
Symmetry argument.
Because it should depend only on the physical.
Yeah, I think there is a bit of subtlety
to it. It's a symmetry argument, because if I had a cosmological constant, everybody admits that term would be.
So
it can't be a symmetry argument, it must be something else.
We are taking the delta phi equals to zero gauge, so the degree of freedom just appears through the metric. So the metric just appears.
Because you have two invariances, you have d3x, because you have x, d3x, a cube, and zeta. So this combination is fine. I think the cosmological constant is there, but that cancels because that would give a tadpole.
Yeah.
So that term is there, but once you solve the constraint equation, it goes away.
Maybe I can say in this way. So okay,
I think what you say in terms of symmetry is dangerous because.
Right, but the e to 3 zeta appears, but you know, the dangerous term is the one which does not accompany e to 3 zeta because otherwise it's just factorized, right? So then, does not accompany e to 3 zeta is the one which accompanies special derivative. Because from the special metric, they appear e to minus 2 zeta. So this means that the term which remains in the large distance is just the one which accompanies all the time derivatives.
Yeah, I think it is a symmetry argument.
But I think you messed with the equation of motion. So anyway, I'm fine. If you don't believe Maldacena, it's OK. Just say, let's say that the proof holds up to Maldacena. I usually consider this OK. Yeah.
OK, let's go for it.
So now let's take the expectation value of, so as I said, there is this source and we need to take expectation values of the source, okay? If this expectation value of the source is zero, then we don't get the time dependence. Anyway, this proof is auto loops. So let's take the expectation value on the shorts and it will take this form. You will take a term, which is a delta function a coincidence, times a function of the long modes, zeta dot long, and so on and so forth, plus the product of the same two functions evaluated, which are functions zeta longs, evaluated at x1 and x2. Let me explain a bit why it takes this form. Every diagram that we compute of this source is between x1 and x2. And every diagram that you can construct, either connects from x1 to x2 involves the correlation function of short modes or of long modes. Now, if you are correlating two short modes, a distance is much larger than Hubble, much larger than the wavelength, their contribution is very small. That is, two short modes, x1 and x2, very different, it just decays. Since we're interested just for Hubble constants, for length scales over the Hubble longer, we can approximate, I mean, it doesn't change anything, but we can take a function which is a local support that just becomes a delta function of x1 minus x2. Then, instead, the other modes can, the other diagrams can be connected between S1 and S2. You can form a diagram where the connection between the two points is given by some long mode. So the shell modes connect here, many shell modes connect here. But these modes connected here just have support at the same location x1. So we'll give you some function of x1. And then they will depend, but because of transition value, cannot depend on x1. But then it can depend on what the long mode does in this location. So it will depend on the long of x1. And the same, actually, in the same way, will depend on zeta long. In the same way, but zeta long evaluated x2. And zeta long between the two points is going to be different. So there are two factorized terms, each one evaluated zeta long at the same point. So these terms are the ones, the diagrams which are short connected, and these terms are long connected. These are all the diagrams. If at least there is a short connected, there's supported coincidence, otherwise the factorizes. Now, this form is still non-trivial. So far I simply explained the factorization and why there is FP, FP here. But in this local coordinate that I took, there is a residual gauge invariance of the theory, which I can just rescale the coordinate and shift back the zeta long, because that's the way it appeared in the metric. And similarly also for the anisotropic, you can do an anisotropic rescaling. This together also with the scaling A fixes that every time there is an x1 delta function of x, there must be an A. This is kind of obvious, okay? But see, because of this, so every time there is a delta function of x, there must be an A. But every time there is an A or another x, I mean, it's just the diagonal symmetry, you must have it to the zeta. So this fixes this term here. And then this means that any time you don't have an x dependence explicit, you must have something proportional to zeta dot, or to gradients of zeta, which are zero, zeta dots, or integral between t1 and t2 to very near time, very nearby time, so zeta dot, something that vanishes if zeta log and lambda and the anisotropic are constant, because the constant term are killed by this shift symmetry if there is not an x or an a compensated.
Leonardo, this is just getting harder and harder for me to follow, because each step seems funny. For example, why? So I agree that if things are short connected, then they have to, or you know, it shouldn't matter if they if you just cut off the distances, but why do they have to have a delta function singularity?
No, this delta function, as I said, I think I said this, take a function which has support, some support
but
over
then,
the half.
Then why does it have to have that 1 over a to the third e to the 3 zeta on it?
Because this is the symmetry. This is the symmetry, okay? This is the whole point is that if you have something with support in x, you must have some factor of zeta because of the symmetry. It's called, this is a we're using symmetry. I'm not doing the whole loops calculation by hand. I'm using symmetry to do the whole proof, all order proof.
You're making assumptions, and I'm not sure how important.
I'm making assumptions that the symmetries are true, yes.
I'm not sure how important those assumptions are. For example, you assume that it had a delta function.
No, that's completely not important. Take a Gaussian. There will be these kind of factors, okay?
Well, why must there be those kinds of factors?
Because every time there is a distance, the distance must be associated with scale A by that gay by the shift symmetry by E.
You're assuming that as time evolves, the normalization doesn't change. Why should it not change? I don't understand.
No, this is just a gauge symmetry of the coordinate system. It's just telling me that I can do the. This is just imposing that I do the right calculation in all coordinate systems. I mean, as I said, in this talk we're assuming that Maldacena is right and that gauge invariance is also right.
But I sure don't see that follows from gauge invariance. I can think of
I just make it this one.
But is this alpha is a constant?
Yeah, yeah, a constant. But you see, it kills the constant.
He's saying that he still has a freedom to do a constant scaling.
Okay, yeah. So why isn't there such a factor on the other term then?
Because factorization, because these are log connected. Thanks for asking that. These are log connected. So you take the expectation value. I'm taking the expectation value only on the short. So the expectation of the short here cannot depend on x1.
Okay. By translation invariance.
By translation invariance, thank you. By translation invariance. Can depend on zeta long at the location, which that's what breaks translation invariance. So it depends on x1 only through zetas.
So it wasn't a symmetry argument, because a symmetry argument would say that the symmetry of the thing on the left-hand side was controlling stuff, and it isn't saying that, because there's a term that has one kind of scaling and another term that has another kind of scaling.
I think this is pretty explicit, I don't know. I mean, sorry, I think I'm talking about two kinds of terms, short connected or long connected, and one of the specified
maybe
form.
This is not important either. Maybe
I think this is crucial, but I can repeat it only a finite number of times.
Okay, then I don't see it at all.
Isn't the key point here the line where you're keeping track, very careful track of this leftover gauge?
Yeah.
I mean, someone could reorganize your diagrammatic counting totally differently. I mean,
right.
In some sense, the proof, but isn't that?
Yeah, that's the crucial step of the proof.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Basically,
you believe
it's
invalid.
Yeah, exactly. Cool. And so.
Could you show me how gauge invariance implies that? I sure don't.
Yeah,
quite
simple.
That's
because
easy, right?
Yeah, just look at the metric.
It can't be some property of
it's
the left hand.
It's a residual symmetry of the original multi-center metric, unless
yeah,
you've done.
Yeah, also it holds in a special thing that is. It's just the usual story that.
Richard, it's not a complete gauge fixing the multi-center metric. That's one way of phrasing it.
A 1 over a to the 3rd e to the 1 or e to the minus 3 zeta l whatever that is on that first term and not on the second term?
Because there's no explicit x. There is no x. It's a diagrammatic proof. So there are two terms because of the way I construct the diagrams. Either sharp connected or long connected. The sharp connected has this delta function sort of term, which, since it has an x dependence, it will bring 1 over a cube, and then it brings this also this zeta l there. Additionally, there is a long connected terms, which don't have any dependence on x1 explicit. Okay, so they don't have any factors of a.
How does that follow from symmetry? I just don't see.
No, it doesn't also, it follows from
symmetry. It does follow from the translation symmetry as a state. So you're combined. There are two symmetries going on here.
Yeah. So do you understand?
Yeah, the translation is kind of three.
How does it follow from translation invariance?
Well, wait. What follows from translation is that the second term, it's quadratic in FB.
Yes.
Each of those factors is actually independent of x, even though there's an x in there.
What is x?
X is a spatial coordinate.
The location in which I'm taking
S
L.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so there, even though there's an x there, the actual quantity is independent of that x by spatial translation of variance of the state. So I think he's invoking that.
Of course. Yes.
So then the fact that the quantity can't actually be changed by a scaling of the coordinate is just automatic for those terms because they don't actually depend on the coordinates.
Mm-hmm.
And then he can focus on the first term where, because it actually depends bilocally on two x's, you know, then it really will involve the difference between the x's.
But as a shame,
then it has to be involve it in such a way that if you simultaneously
I can think of lots of dependences such that, for example, take a scalar propagator. That's a perfectly good thing that becomes peaked at x1 equals x2.
It will decay. It's something that must decay with distance, and then it will have this property.
I just gave you a counterexample. Take a scalar propagator.
Actually, so we cannot.
No, but short mode. I mean, we're talking about a connection between short modes. So there is a dedicated.
Take a scalar propagator. It becomes peaked. It has a universal Hadamard behavior at short distances. It becomes.
Okay, you should be able to do that.
At x1 equals x2, and it doesn't have that scaling. I just don't understand.
I think it does everything. I mean,
why do you think it doesn't have that scale?
Because I know what it's Hadamard behavior is 1 over norm of at equal times. Its Hadamard behavior is universal as 1 over norm of x1 minus x2.
So put the a's there, and you will get this kind of surprise.
Have to be careful to do it in this gauge. You look at that scalar propagator in this gauge, and it'll have this symmetry, sort of just by definition of.
It'll become divergent at coincidence, but it doesn't become divergent like that.
No, I think this is not important for the proof. The important part of the proof is that there is one of.
Okay, if it's not important,
no.
Please go ahead.
I think we have to use a bit of. What is important? What is important for the proof is the fact that the correlator of short modes decays at long distances. Once it decays,
you put an A's and an e to the 3 zeta together with the x's because they're just this gauge invariants. It's really, I mean.
So it's important that the correlator that becomes coincident at short distances decays at long distances. I can think of counterexamples to that too.
Only made of short modes, I don't think so.
Is it necessary that it have that property? I mean.
It is a true fact of life that short modes, their correlation long distances decays. Yeah, I mean, if you take something, just Fourier analysis, I mean, just a trivial fact that if you take an x1 here, an x2 here, you ask the correlation function just built on very short, almost much shorter than the distance, it just doesn't contribute.
Is it necessary that I agree with that?
No, I mean, at some point, not necessary. I mean, it's okay. Maybe I care about the other. I mean,
okay.
Again, what can I do? I mean, if using, I mean, common logic, like the fact that every net is a times there is an x, you don't put an a.
Well, now you're calling me stupid.
No, no.
I'm not stupid. I've done a lot of these calculations, and I'm trying
very hard to understand
your analysis, and I just can't. Every step, it's another new thing that seems strange.
Okay, let me just go on, and then maybe we can discuss more. I don't know. Yeah. Okay, so now we take the expectation value. Next step. So any function which has a compact behavior will have this and plus this. This is the expectation on the short. Now let me take the expectation value on the long mode as well. So this is the expectation of the first term, and this is the expectation value of the second term. Now, because of iteration, every lower order zeta dot decays. It's computed from the lower order, so it decays. This doesn't decay, it's a constant, but it's the 1 over a cube down there. So you see that the source function is zero on the expectation value, is zero at the time, because each term decays and this 1 over a cube also decays. So this means, but since the Greek function has no support unless you put t prime close to t, there is nothing at t prime of order t, so the source function is zero, and so the correlator of zeta dot is zero as you go to time infinity, order by order perturbation theory. Okay, so this is for the two-point function. The same holds for the three-point function, I mean, any n-point function. So zeta dot is, as an operator, is zero. Every correlator function is zero.
But you assume the Bunch-Lipps, right?
Yes. But no, I think for the non-Bunch-Lipps vacuum, it will be zero later. So I was discussing this with one. Right. That is, it goes to zero. I'm not saying when it goes to zero.
Yeah, but what I meant is, so
there could be some delay.
It's not the Bunch-Lipps, the time integral is not convergent.
Ah, but you're thinking of alpha vacua?
Right, in the past. So if we... there could be another one, but I don't think it can hold as operator.
Point polite. Yes. Okay. Notice that here, no calculation, only symmetries were used. No, this is no calculation proof. However, I think, very importantly, so in cosmology, previously, we had explicitly verified that this logic that applied to this proof will be learned in one loop order. Because in cosmology, it is very easy to prove wrongly a result that everybody thinks is true. It's extremely easy. In fact, one can even go along with a result that everybody thinks is wrong and nobody questions it. So we have done a calculation one loop, which is a very tactical and challenging proof, following a paper by you, which I think is incorrect. And this is a very very challenging computation. There is a one-loop computation in quantum gravity. And the crucial step in the one-loop computation, which is very explicit and use all the ingredients, is that you need to adjust the background to ensure the tadpole cancellation. And since by default of physics environment, the tadpoles are non-linear, they also lead to quadratic terms that are very important. So the tadpole terms contribute not only to the one-point function, but also to the two-point function.
Let me see if I can decode that. Tadpole terms mean changes of
the background.
Value of zeta?
Not that. Yeah, of the variable zeta.
So you're saying that zeta does evolve?
Yeah. If you do the calculation, like, for example, some wrong way, and I can mention some wrong papers, the variable zeta dot, or zeta dot, the zero-point function, the one-point function, is non-zero naively, because the short modes, actually it's non-zero, it is, if you take a three-level background, and, sorry, if
Very few people read the paper. If you didn't read the paper, it's a disaster, because then I don't know who read it. But the three-level, the zeta dot, the short modes renormalize the background of stress tensor, the stress tensor, the homogeneous part of the stress tensor of inflation. Therefore, the inflation resolution will be different. The background of the cosmology will be different than the three-level. If you do the calculation zeta in the wrong, in the three-level cosmology, you get this kind of contribution. As a cosmological constant, that exactly as a.
Isn't that just the admission that zeta is going to be time
dependent? So.
Well, but the fact that zeta's time dependence is equivalent to the fact that the cosmology is rolling. It's so, it's kind of a trivial effect, just the fact that the cosmology is rolling.
It's that quantum corrections are changing the background, right?
Yes. Now let's define zeta around the correct background. The one loop, all loops background. That's a trivial effect, just a normalization of the background, not the fluctuation. So this is the zero mode, but I mean, by translation invariant, we believe is true. This is the zero mode, the k equals zero mode, gets a time dependence by the fact that a one loop, or at any, for example, one loop, there is a normalization of the cosmological constant.
Okay, so.
So this term, however, you see, is not linear, it's quadratic, cubic, and so on and so forth.
Yes.
So the presence of this term, which clearly is wrong because it changed, it gives a verb to zeta, will affect also the two-point function of zeta.
Well, you say it's wrong because it gives a verb.
I mean, it gives a verb to zeta, so is not the this means that we're not talking about the zeta we were normally talking about. We don't want to talk about zeta. I mean, we're not doing the cosmology around the true background. This, by the quadratic term here, will induce a tuple, a time dependence in zeta. That is, there is a contribution from the cosmological constant, from the induced cosmological constant from the loop, that source is zeta zero. But since this term is, this term enters in the loop, in the tuple function, because then I can attach a leg to this leg and create a contribution to the tuple function. And then I also, the same diagram that normalizes the stress tensor, the background, also leads to a quartic interaction of this. For example, take an interaction which is zeta squared d zeta short squared. If I take the verb here, it's like a renormalization of the kinetic term of the stress tensor. It will induce a tadpole for zeta zero, because there is also zeta here. Oh, let's make it e to the zeta, okay, e to the 3 zeta here. There is a tadpole, but also a quartic diagram. And this quartic diagram will be appearing in a one loop in the tuple function. But this diagram cancels with this diagram. So one needs to take into account the background, the tadpole induced, very, very carefully. The simplest way to do it is to ensure that this tadpole is zero.
Okay?
Yes?
So can I rephrase that as saying that you're using your residual symmetry to cancel the tadpoles order by order?
No, I think this is a physical effect. This is a, I am not. No, can I explain?
No, I want to
answer first. No, this is the fact that the background cosmology in one loop is going to be different. And so I'm defining zeta. I mean.
Okay, it's a field redefinition. Sorry. It's physical, but it's a field redefinition.
No, it's a physical change. It's another thing that they claimed can't occur. It's back reaction occurring.
No, it's not back reaction. It's just saying that I'm defining.
It isn't?
I'm defining. Zeta, you can do two ways. First, you can define zeta around the correct background, the one loop, all loop FRW background, homogeneous background. You can define this. Or you cannot redefine zeta this way, but you need to take into account of this kind of diagram as well, where there is the zero mode, the zero mode, which, by the way, as you see, I think you know, is super not gauge fixed. If there is a gauge residual, so the zero mode is a tragedy. So you need to gauge fix the zero mode, do very, very careful job with the zero mode. If you do it, you will. This diagram, some of this diagram, will cancel with this diagram.
I see, and so the smart thing to do is?
Is to adjust the tadpoles so that there is this diagram is canceled by the tadpole counter term.
Okay.
The tadpole counter term, you put it so that there is not this diagram. But this tadpole counter term, I don't know if you're familiar with something, the Fatty Taylor inflation, brings also quadratic term that will cancel this term. Now there is a quadratic term here, and which is the same coefficient by diffeomorphism invariant.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so this is, for example, something wasn't done. And also, you have to, many of the remaining diagrams that don't cancel actually group together into the so called
some terms that for which you can use the Maldacena continuous condition to show that that total derivative, that the diagrams whose sum is just a total derivative, it doesn't contribute to the loop integral. Because total derivatives and the loop integrals don't contribute. So this is a huge set of diagrams that cancel among each other because the symmetry we're talking about, which is the crucial step, is non-linear. And so means that this term is connected to this term. And this, and since I'm using, in the proof, I've used this symmetry, which means diagrammatically that this term and this term must talk to each other, must play a crucial role in the cancellation of the divergences, because they're connected by the same symmetry. So this was a very hard compilation. You need to do some physical iteration, but also you need patience and determination. In fact, we never finished for the tensor modes because of that. That our determination went down. Okay, let me summarize. So I think it's very nice to study loops and inflation. I mean, here we have an expert. To study the effects on modes at a scale of modes, scale effects on modes at a scale on modes at different scales. That's what loops means. In single field, there are potential dynamical and projection effects. Dynamical effects shut down when either of the modes is out of the horizon. So there is no dynamical effect. In fact, I give the loop proofs of the absolute effect for shorter modes. And the only thing we're left with, as I said the other time, was this logarithmic running. So this talk today was about this, which is a very non-trivial effect. But there are projection effects. And the effect for longer modes cancels while asking about local observables. So there are no effect in local AM, not local observables. Instead, shorter mode changed the mapping, as I was discussing today, between, and I brought to the beginning, between horizon crossing time and observed scale. And this is the same effect that leads to slow roll and inflation and the resummation I discussed the other time. So this is this is all.
Okay, well, thank you for giving us this.